Welcome to this week's edition of Flashback Friday, your opportunity to get some good review by listening to episodes from the past that Jason has handpicked to help you today in the present and propel you into the future. Enjoy.
Welcome to the Holistic Survival Show with Jason Hartman. The economic storm brewing around the world is set to spill into all aspects of our lives. Are you prepared? Where are you going to turn for the critical life skills necessary to survive and prosper? The Holistic Survival Show is your family's insurance for a better life. Jason will teach you to think independently, to understand threats, and how to create the ultimate action plan. Sudden change or worst case scenario, you'll be ready. Welcome to Holistic Survival, your key resource for protecting the people, places, and profits you care about in uncertain times. Ladies and gentlemen, your host, Jason Hartman.
Welcome to the Holistic Survival Show. This is your host, Jason Hartman, where we talk about protecting the people, places, and profits you care about in these uncertain times. We have a great interview for you today, and we will be back with that in less than 60 seconds on the Holistic Survival Show. And by the way, be sure to visit our website at holisticsurvival.com. You can subscribe to our blog, which is totally free, has loads of great information, and there's just a lot of good content for you on the site. So make sure you take advantage of that at holisticsurvival.com. We'll be right back. Hey, it's my pleasure to welcome Charles Goyette back to the show. He is the host of Ron Paul's America radio show and podcast, and he's got a great background with a whole bunch of other awesome things on his resume, and I'll let him maybe tell you about a few of those. Charles, welcome. How are you?
Jason, great to speak with you. Please don't make me talk about them all.
Oh, okay. Well, you can give a Reader's Digest version then. How's that sound?
Well, I'm the author of a couple of timely books, one called The Dollar Meltdown, which was an international bestseller, and my latest book is called Red and Blue and Broke All Over, How to Restore America's Free Economy. And the main impact, I suppose, of the book is that I'm not sure that anybody really wants to restore American prosperity or to restore the American dream. Oh, you individually and your listeners individually and many other people individually, if you ask them, yes, we would like to restore our prosperity, yes, we would like to restore the American dream, then these are the sorts of things that we would need to do so. But if you ask the people in this country on a corporate or collective level through their elected representatives to do the things that need to be done to restore American prosperity, to make sure that the American dream is alive for not only ourselves and our golden years, as they call them, and our retirements and our kids and their aspirations to own homes and have a long lifetime and their kids to have a better future than they themselves had and so on. I'm not sure that collectively or in the political body we're really willing to do the things necessary. So that's that book. But the main thing I'm really proud of now, because it reaches so many people, is the Ron Paul radio show. We're on about 125 radio stations across the country twice a day with commentaries on things going on in the news. And the big one is a long form podcast that anybody can avail themselves of. You can simply download it at podcast1.com or at my website, charlesgoyette.com. But it's a chance to hear Ron at length on what the big issues are of the day that are affecting people's lives in America, their prosperity in America, their futures in America.
Well, I'll tell you something, Charles. If our electorate listened to podcasts rather than the lamestream media, we would have a much better government. Because what you're saying, when you mentioned it a couple times, you said long form podcast, and television is truly the idiot's medium. Because it's always a soundbite. And it's like, we have elections that are won or lost on these dumb, flippin' soundbites. It is absurd that, I mean, are the American people really this shallow that they're going to let a thing like read my lips, no new taxes, determine the next president? I mean, there's a lot more complexity to it than that, or hope and change, or binders of women. I mean, you know, these are just silly. This is silliness, right?
I agree with you. Yeah. And it is a lot more complex. But, you know, the political debate has been dumbed down by the two parties. I mean, they have turned it into a, you know, an advanced auction on stolen goods. They have turned America into what I call the American pinata, in which all they do, the political parties and their chosen candidates, are involved in passing the big stick around and making sure everybody in their demographic group, in their ethnic group, in their regional group, whatever groups they may be members of, make sure they get a crack at the American pinata with a stick. And they hope, of course, to bust loose some goodies for each other. And the real reason that we never solve it is that the Republicans don't think that they do it. And the Democrats think it's all the Republicans, you know, that want to, fortify the military-industrial complex or whatever it may be. Each party wants to blame the other one. And both are certainly fully deserving of blame. But until they clean up their own houses, the Democrats clean up their house and the Republicans clean up their house, then this situation will go on until, you know what happens at the end of the pinata party. I mean, the pinata itself is busted up beyond repair and unrecognizable. And they've turned America, this great noble idea, into a pinata. And all they do is pass the big stick around. And you're right, too. The media plays the part of like the mariachi band. They're there just to keep the festive spirits high and persuade everybody that this party is the normal sorts of things. Here, take a whack at the American pinata. Get yourself some goodies. Vote for the candidate that promises you the most. Oh, you get more goodies from the R's or more goodies from the D's? Why would you vote for the D's if you're going to get more from the R's? Why would you vote for the R's if you get more from the D's? Yada, yada, yada. It's all absolute nonsense. It leaves America poorer. And in the course of doing this, you're right, they make a slogans out of these issues that certainly divide the people. There's no question that people could be divided about these headline or bumper sticker issues, but the fundamental things that impact America's freedom and prosperity going forward, the things that I care about, and I suspect you care about too, are the things they never talk about. They never talk about, you know, the American military empire and the reach of it and the way that it's bankrupting the country. They never talk about the destruction of the monetary system by the central bank. You can go through an entire presidential campaign, and we just did a year or so ago, and you never hear, for example, the Federal Reserve even mentioned. Isn't that peculiar, Jason? I mean, money is a...
Well, except by Ron Paul, let's audit the Fed, which is like this crazy idea. Paul. Yeah, right. Yeah. It's just unbelievable. Well, it's because these mainstream candidates are bought and, you know, owned by the Fed and the Rothschild family, you know, everybody else. But we don't need to go there and get too far afield, because people just kind of, I don't know, they just get funny when you start talking about it.
Well, you don't even have to go far afield. Yeah. I mean, I think it's all right there in the open.
It is.
You know, since 2008, the Fed has created, think about this, the Fed has created well over $3 trillion out of thin air. And where did the money go? The money went to reliquify the money center banks, the crony banks, the influential banksters. It went to take toxic mortgages and broken down securities off of their books and put them on the books of the Federal Reserve, and effectively on the books of the American dollar or the American people as a proxy. So they transfer bad risk, toxic assets onto the books of the people, and they bail out the influential cronies with $3 trillion in money printing that nobody ever voted for, that never gets audited, that nobody really understands how this is happening and how it works.
It is literally mind-boggling that we have come to this. I mean, it is in so many ways. But hey, no need to comment on that. We all know it's ridiculous, it's crazy, it's absurd, and it really gets us all hot under the collar. I want to ask you about something a little more current, though, Charles.
Sure.
There's a lot going on in foreign policy right now, and it has wide-ranging effects for us economically. You know, one of the things I was discussing with you, we talked for like 2 minutes off air before we started today, and, you know, I said, foreign policy, that's interesting, but unless you can bring it back to how it's going to hit someone in the pocketbook, it's more like a big theory instead of something that's real. But it is real, isn't it?
It is so real, and let me give you an example of just how real it is. I mean, this is, if you peel the onion back, the thing starts to look a little bit like the product of an insane asylum. Here, John Kerry arrives in Kiev the other day with all the problems in the Kiev in Ukraine, and he's waving around a taxpayer guarantee, effectively a check from the American people, of $1 billion. to throw into the mix to help them out in whatever, for whatever purposes. Now, wait a minute. Wait a minute. The United States is virtually insolvent. We have, you know, a $17 trillion plus invisible national debt, well over $100 trillion in hidden national debt. So for us to give $1 billion away, where do we get it? Money being fungible, effectively, we have to go out and borrow it. We don't have an excess. We don't have a reserve account, so we have to go out and borrow it. So when we borrow $1 billion to give to Ukraine, where do we get it? Well, we borrow it from foreign lenders like, well, let me surprise everybody, like Russia. Do people know that Russia is a major creditor of the United States Treasury just the same way that, say, China is? Yes, Russia is. So the little children of the future that are out on the playgrounds of the schools today having a good time are being loaded down with additional debt by the United States government, additional Treasury debt that will burden them the rest of their lives, so that the established parties, the governing classes in America, can go deliver $1 billion check. And by the way, they promised that Obama would have more money where that came from for Ukraine. So you give $1 billion to Ukraine. But wait a minute. When the money shows up in Ukraine, what does Ukraine do with it? Well, the $1 billion, it doesn't go to the Ukrainian people. It doesn't make them richer. The $1 billion is used to pay Gazprom, which is the major Russian gas company, which is owed $2 billion by Ukraine. So wait a minute. Let's think this thing through now, step by step. The American people borrow money from places like Russia so we can give it to places like Ukraine so that they can pay back places like Russia. And the bankers that have provided loans to Ukraine, risky loans, that they didn't have to worry about being defaulted upon by Ukraine, even though Ukraine has defaulted twice in the last 10 years, they didn't have to worry about those defaults because they know that they can get a better interest rate return than Americans can by investing in crazy places like Ukraine. And then if something goes wrong and the debt can't be repaid, like the Greek debt, that somebody like the IMF or the United States government and the European Union will step in and make them whole. So this is a little bit of insanity, but if you peel the onion back another layer, you see that it's all the business of the banksters.
But you know, Charles, I really don't quite understand why you're complaining. Now, this is a sarcastic comment. I'm
sure
I want you to know when I say this.
I can tell in the
because,
sound of your voice.
Yeah, okay, good. I just want to make sure you caught my tone here. I don't really understand why you're complaining, and here's why. Because isn't this just increasing the velocity of money?
Yeah. Well, there you go. That's good. We're going to increase our velocity of money right into national bankruptcy.
Yeah, yeah.
Is what we're going to do. It's actually the biggest. It's the biggest wealth transfer scheme in the history of mankind.
Well, okay. I mean, so go into that a little bit more. So what specifically is the biggest wealth transfer scheme in the history of mankind? Central banking?
Well, sure.
Well, yeah. Okay.
Central banking and fiat money. So everybody that, so the central banks depreciate the value of the currency that people hold in their piggy banks, in their wallets, in their banks, that they get their retirement income paid in, anything denominated in dollars. The central bank depreciates that by inflating the currency, by destroying the purchasing power of the dollar over time. So I guess to describe it in a different way is to say in America, the founders set up a perfectly reasonable system for the government to pay for things that it wants. And the system is, you know, appropriations, money bills. You know, we have a Congress, we have a legislature, we have money bills. They have to originate. Congress, the Constitution says money bills have to originate in the House. That is the people's representatives, the people closest to the people that are up for election every 2 years. So spending bills have to originate there. They come from there, and then they go through the process, and they, you know, have to be, they have to pass both bodies of the legislature. And then they go to the president, he has to sign, and then he executes them or carries out the intention of the legislature. But you have this huge, massive monetary operation that runs to trillions, nay, tens of trillions of dollars to pay for things, to buy things, to enable things, to transfer wealth, to benefit cronies, that never sees the legislative process. It never sees a vote of appropriations. We spent the Federal Reserve extended $16 trillion during the 2008-2009 meltdown. 16 $1 trillion to foreign companies, domestic banks, foreign banks, foreign governments, at the risk of the solvency or the value of the United States paper dollar, $16 trillion, without so much as a single vote, without so much as exposure to public debate. So, and all of this, of course, is done at the expense of the American people, because, look, the Fed doesn't create any wealth. The people listening to your show right now create wealth. A waitress that delivers a sandwich and pours coffee, that's creating wealth. Somebody puts tires on your car, that's creating wealth. Somebody grows food, that's creating wealth. Somebody delivers a package, that's creating wealth. All the things that people do are creating wealth, and they earn money. Nothing the Federal Reserve does creates wealth. They don't have any money. The only money they have is the money that they take from the people. Yet they do it by subterfuge. They do it rather than through legislative process, so at least we know how we're being fleeced. They just do it on the QT. It's not compatible with the nature of a free people.
So are you saying that because of all this silly spending, silly is, just my cute word for it. It's, of course, aggravating as hell. Because of all this massively destructive spending, that we have an inflationary future? I mean, that's the only way out, right? Is to inflate our way out, or do you have another theory?
No, it's clearly the only way out. It means the destruction of the currency. Somebody asked me one time, how many paper currencies like ours have been destroyed over the course of history? And the answer to that is all of them. You know, ours, it hasn't quite happened yet, but that's ours, the trajectory of ours, too. And so the people are impoverished in these things, people that save, people that you know, all the things that make capitalism work, all the savings and investing and prudence and so on that makes capitalism work and created the remarkable prosperity that America created to display to the world, all of those values are undermined in this process. And so it's true that the Fed has gotten away with increasing its balance sheet with made-up money, but printing money, from about $800 billion when the mortgage meltdown hit and the recession started, in, let's say 2008. But it was about $800 billion. There it was. It rolled along. If you looked at the chart, it's about $800 billion, shazam, straight up like a hockey stick. And it goes from $800 billion to $1.6 trillion. And then shazam, it doubles again from $1.6 trillion to $3.2 trillion. And shazam, now it's over $4 trillion. This represents money that they just made up to buy things off of the hands of the banks, as we talked about earlier, or to buy the downgraded debt of the United States. Yes, to enable the reckless spending of members of Congress who are there to do nothing more than to give things away, American pinata, to give things away to buy the votes of their constituents so that they could get reelected. So we've got the balance sheet of the Fed has grown by well over $3 trillion in a couple of years with money they just printed, and everybody says, well, what are the consequences of that? We don't see any consequences. And the answer to that story is that the consequences aren't apparent yet because the money has yet to enter the commercial loaning activity of the banks. And when it does, then it starts getting multiplied many times over in the fractional reserve banking system. So to make all of this understandable in one little burrito, let me wrap the thought up. The Fed has printed a lot of money, but it's kind of like it's just been sitting there, and it's been humming like a nuclear reactor, it's just humming and it's wobbling, and there's something there, and all of a sudden it starts to leak this fissionable material. Well, that money is starting to leak out now into the commercial banking system, and we want a recovery, but a recovery means that the banks are going to begin making loans, and they make loans to businesses that hire people and so on and so forth. And those loans are what really not only ejects that money into the currency and the circulating currency and monetary system of the country, but it's multiplied many times over by a process I'm sure you've discussed many times called fractional reserve lending.
Oh, yes.
And that's the magic
of money creation, fractional reserve lending. Otherwise, that process is starting right now. Yeah, right.
It's starting right now with 2014. The amount of commercial bank leasing and loaning activity has started to turn up.
Yeah, no question about it. So, Charles, I mean, the question is all this bad? I mean, logically, empirically, it would seem like it's bad. So the answer to my question about inflation, yes, we've got inflation coming. Is that your answer?
Massive.
Okay, massive inflation. How much, can you define massive? I mean, I know there's, nobody knows, of course. You don't know, nobody knows. It's all a prediction.
Right.
But, you know, what do you think? I mean, just take a gander.
Well, it's destructive enough at 2% or 5% or 10%, but it really, as it approaches double digits, and we've been at double digits many times in the lives of most baby boomers.
Yeah. I mean, in the 70s, we were in double digits.
Four or five times. So when it starts to get to that level, the problem is bad for any country, but it's much worse for the United States because we have persuaded the rest of the world to use our dollars. And when our dollars start losing value at that rate, the rest of the world will reject them. They will not finance our debt. Why should, in other words, why should they loan money to the United States government when they loan a dollar, they know they're going to get paid back 90 cents in value?
Yeah, because we inflate away the value of the debt, which is the exact strategy.
The value of the debt.
Which is the exact strategy. That's exactly the strategy I recommend
and
that our investors use.
And they know this.
But yes, they know it.
But
Charles, look, here's the problem. You're right about all of this. I mean, I agree. The only thing is, though, we've been inflating the value of our debt away for a long time,
right.
and they're still buying it. What's going on behind the scenes? What really makes you think that in the future our treasury auctions are suddenly going to be boycotted and nobody's going to buy them when they've been buying them all along? It's not like we weren't doing this 10 years ago. It's not like we weren't doing it 20, 30 years ago. It's not new. I mean, we've been doing this for decades.
Yes, you're right. We've been doing it for decades, and there's never been a real viable alternative. But the problem is that at some point,
a viable a viable alternative for other countries to invest in. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, more or less. And I'm maybe not even clear about that. Let me put the dollar in different terms for your listeners to say that in the case of, you know, when you have Europe going through a crisis and the value of the dollar comes up and people start clamoring to buy more dollars and dollar-dominated assets, dollar bonds, and so on and so forth. It's, you know, I think of it like you take your employees, you have a company picnic, and you go to the park and you play some volleyball or softball and have a big picnic, and then all of a sudden it starts to sprinkle, and everybody runs under the Ramada for cover for a few minutes, and you get out of the rain, and you keep, you know, you're still having a good time, you're still having hot dogs and stuff, but you're out of the rain, and if it continues to rain at some point, you know, people start to go home. The United States is like the Ramada, and it's a good place for people to bail out of problems in foreign countries elsewhere in the world when there's a crisis, and come to the United States where they know at least when push comes to shove that at least the money will be printed to pay back the money that they loaned to the U.S.
The United States has always had the reputation, I mean, not always, but, you know, as long as we can remember or care about, of being the Brinks truck of the world, the safe place to put your money. Because, you know, it's a stable government, theoretically.
but that Ramada that I'm talking about is becoming a short-term instrument rather than a long-term. In other words, it's fine to get out of the sprinkle or the rain when you're at the ballpark and climb, you know, get under the cover of the Ramada. But nobody wants to live there. Nobody wants to weather a hurricane in a place like that.
Okay, so where else are they going to go to weather it, though? Bitcoin?
Well, here's the brilliance of markets. The brilliance of markets is that necessity is the mother of invention. And when people reach the point of being fleeced and they don't want to be fleeced any longer, they start developing alternatives, looking for alternatives, coming up with new novel things that cannot be imagined today, but will be developed. But you see this going on all over the world right now.
Charles, I just want to understand something. So, and when you say fleeced, you're talking about the investors in U.S. treasuries being fleeced because the value of the debt that they're essentially buying from us, loaning us the money to finance our drunken sailor spending habits, they are fleeced through inflation because they get paid back in cheaper dollars. That's the fleecing you're talking about.
Right.
Okay.
That is right.
So and And so far, they've been willing to get fleeced because there's no other Ramada, as you put it. There's no other place to run. So, yeah, you're talking. Now, go ahead. Now, that's where you left off.
Okay, because we're seeing these alternatives begin to develop now before our very eyes.
Like cryptocurrencies.
For somebody like me that watches this all the time, you know, it seems to be happening at breakneck speed, but it's not just cryptocurrencies. It's the remarkable move we've had this millennium in the price of gold. It's these multilateral and bilateral relationships that are being created all over the world. You saw one the other day. It was kind of the outcropping of the sanctions we imposed on Russia, that Russia and Iran are firming up their trading relationship. Turkey's been trading gold for oil from Iran, and now Russia and Iran have created a non-dollar denominated trading structure to settle deals instead of in dollars, the reserve currency of the world, to settle deals in their own currencies. Russia and China are doing this. This stuff, the Gulf Cooperation Council is doing this. This is going on all over the world, that people are arranging bilateral multinational deals to create trading structures that will insulate them from the dollar. Happening very fast.
Yeah, well, so you know my theory on that is it's kind of like, and look, I'm not a parent, but I did have a parent, okay, so I understand the concept here. When you're doing something bad, maybe you're in high school and you go out drinking, and of course you shouldn't be drinking in high school, and mom kind of knows about it, but she sort of looks the other way so as not to put maybe too much parental pressure on you, but, you know, she's going to watch it and monitor it, and if it gets to be a problem, she's going to come down on you like a ton of bricks. And so maybe this is just sort of the U.S. just sort of looks at this like, okay, we got our little rebellious teenagers and, you know, they're doing some stuff. They got their little club going with a Gulf cooperation and, you know, Iran and Russia. But if any of this stuff starts to really take hold, the U.S. is going to use its extremely huge advantage. And it's unfair. It's a bully pulpit, no question, of having the largest economy, having the largest military, most importantly, having the economic hitmen all over the world. And the U.S. is going to keep the dollar is probably the most valuable power the U.S. exerts over the world, having reserve currency status. I mean, we're not going to give that up. I mean, we're not going to
It's not for us to decide whether we give it up or
not. You sure about that?
Yeah, I'm quite sure, because we're in the unfortunate situation of being dependent on the kindness of strangers. We have to have foreigners willing to buy our debt.
What I'm saying,
they have to be willing to buy our debt.
Hey, if you put a gun to somebody's head, they will do what you say. And that's what we do. And I think my theory is a lot of these wars are really fake. They're fake wars to exert power in other domains. And I don't understand it well enough. I've just had, you know, a bunch of people on my shows talking about it. It's something I've listened to and read about and learned. But, you know, like I've heard the theory about the only two countries that really don't participate in the global central banking cartel are Iran and North Korea, and that's why we hate them. You know, maybe you have some comment or you can educate me further on that. But these kinds of things, like the war isn't necessarily... We didn't go there for what the media told us. There were other things going on, like maybe pulling away from our reserve currency power.
Well, there are certainly a lot of components of that that figure in. In fact, you know, to get a war, you've got to get a coalition of a lot of different... I'm not talking about a coalition of the willing or coalition of other countries, but you have to get a lot of interest groups in the United States, for example. To the war in Iraq was a good example. You had to have a lot of different interest groups. There were people that thought it would be good for the stock market. There were people that thought it would be good for the defense industry. There were people that thought it would be good for the Republicans in the midterm election. There were people that thought it would be good for banking. There were people that thought it would be good for oil. There were people that thought it would be good for their geopolitical interests overseas. And all of these coalitions came together. They all thought it would be good for their own reasons. So sure, when you get a war, there are reasons like that. And of course, the, you know, maintaining the dollar standard is one of them. But if you look between, in my view, if you look between the pages of the government's behavior, we are a government that has spent beyond our means, and we are beginning to have to live beneath our means. And you see almost the capitulation of the federal government, revealing how weak it is now, not only domestically in things like in things that it resisted with a fervor before, about marijuana laws in the several states, medical marijuana and things. The standoff, the range war standoff the other day in
Mexico or Arizona. I don't know where that even was. I can't remember. Yeah,
but you're seeing this all over the place. You know, the reluctance of the United States to push its advantage because it knows it doesn't have what it had to back it up. I mean, we were talking about geopolitics. You have forces clamoring for us to do something in Ukraine. You have Senators McCain and Lindsey Graham, that want us to start, arming these people. You have people at, I think I saw a guy at the American Enterprise Institute, wants more permanent forces in Central Asia. Oh, my God, does he realize how big Central Asia is? I mean, you have all kinds of people who want to get it. At the same time, we have issued security guarantees around the world. Look, issuing guarantees is no cost for the politicians. When they guarantee your mortgage, when they guarantee your education loan, it's, they're heroes. They get applauded. Oh, you've made home affordable. You've made college affordable to my kids. We're going to reelect. There's no cost. When those loans are defaulted upon, there's a huge cost to the nation and to the people, as we experienced, for example, in the savings and loan crisis. There's a huge cost to the people. By then, the politicians are gone. It's long since forgotten that they gave away these guarantees. Well, they do this in foreign affairs as well. They have given away guarantees all over the world that act as a tripwire to make sure that the United States is deeply involved in future conflagrations that have nothing to do with our interest to protecting the liberty and prosperity of the American people. So while we're watching Ukraine, the current government of China is growing more and more belligerent, more and more outspoken about places like the Senkaku Islands, and just this past weekend, they were shaking their fist, warning Japan and the Philippines and others, that any provocation is going to be met with, severe force and so on. When Deng Xiaoping, the great reformer of China, was running things, his advice was stay low in the geopolitics of the world, maintain a low profile, and build our own prosperity, transform China into a rich country. That advice now has gone out the window. Maybe they think they're rich enough, but it was their prevailing advice there for a long time. This current Premier Li is more militant than anything that we have seen there. So you see the United States, making security guarantees all over the world, people clamoring for us to get involved in things everywhere, including treaties that date back to before the Cold War that obligate us to protect some rocky outcropping in the South China Sea with a couple of goats on it. So this is the sort of thing that bankrupts a nation, and that's one of the reasons that we're, indebted to the extent that we are. So at some point, once you become dependent on the kindness of others to fund your spending, you're no longer your own master.
Yep. Well, that is certainly a scary truth, no question about it. And my only claim with all of that, Charles, is that the U.S. finds itself in a unique position with its military power that can bully its way into forcing other countries to buy its debt and to do its bidding. It's not fair. It's not right. I'm just saying it is.
Dr. Paul has a thought about this that I think is actually very profound. And that is that yes, we have been successful in doing a lot of things like that for a very long time. And the consequences of that are that when we do have a problem, there's going to be a lot of piling on. But we've developed a great deal of enmity, and there's a lot of resentment now for our having done that for a long time. And so when we are in a moment of peril,
we don't have so many friends.
You are exactly right.
Yeah, no question about it. Well, very interesting talk. So on your inflation thoughts there, any double digits, maybe worse, you think? And any time frame ideas?
Yeah, I think it's clear. It'd certainly be double digits, you know, and of course the future can't be told entirely because it depends on decisions that are yet to be made. I mean, there will be decisions made as we move into the crisis. The cake is baked to the extent that we will have a crisis. I mean, the money has already been spent. The debts are very real. The resources to pay them are not there. So somebody will eat those debts, and the most time-honored way for governments is to try to, you know, deflate them or devalue them through inflation in one manner or another. So that's a very real prospect, and it's certainly double digits are no high barrier for the extent of the crisis that we've got in.
And double digits historically, you know, when you look at the entire world, I mean, double digits are nothing. I had Martin Armstrong on the show the other day from Armstrong Economics. You may know of him. And he said that his definition for hyperinflation is, get this, you're going to just, I hope you're sitting down, is
okay,
400% per month or more.
Well, let me give you a different one.
Ouch.
Let me give you a different one, because you're right. There, you know, it's very subjective. But the great economist Ludwig von Mises said, well, it results at some point in what he calls the crack-up boom. And that's more descriptive than numerical. But the crack-up boom is when suddenly a realization comes upon the people at seemingly at once, like you've seen a flock of birds turn at once, or if you've ever scuba dived around the tropical fish, you know, they're going in one direction, suddenly they all turn simultaneously. He said it's a moment at which the consciousness is clear to everybody in the country that it's not just a question of prices going up, but that the currency is losing value. And when that realization dawns on them, as seemingly at some moment, it's what he calls the crack-up boom, and people become desperate to exchange the currency for anything of value. What have you got? Oh, you got a fax machine that doesn't work anymore? I'll take it. What have you got? A hairbrush? I'll buy your hairbrush. I mean, literally anything to get rid, you know, get rid of the paper money that is losing value and turn it into something real, something tangible. So to me, that's hyperinflation when you reach the crack-up boom. And certainly if bad enough decisions are made in the future, and we have a cast and crew of characters that are capable of making a lot more bad decisions.
Yeah, we definitely do. Well, they're all beholden to their constituents of dependent vote buyers, basically, is what the whole thing has become, this iron triangle. It's ridiculous, of course.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. And, you know, there are, I suppose, a few that know better, but they think that, you know, the most important objective is to get themselves reelected, to retain their hold on power.
They're just greedy pigs.
And there are others that really don't know. They're really not that bright. You know, we had, I suppose you saw Congressman Jim Moran the other day complaining that American members of Congress are paid too little money. Said,
$174,000
or whatever.
The troops in the trenches make like $22,000 or something. This is absurd.
And Congressman Paul said, you know, well, if he thinks they're paid too, if they think they're paid too little money, let them go out in the free market and see what they can earn.
Exactly.
And the truth is, the very few of them can do that well in the free market, because they're not as bright. You know, my old friend was a libertarian, well, Republican, but a real libertarian congressman named Sam Steiger for many years. And Sam Steiger used to say, in fact, got himself in trouble with his colleagues when he said on national TV that most of these people that he serves with, you wouldn't hire them to push a wheelbarrow.
Oh, of course you wouldn't. Yeah, they're just lazy. They're just on the take. And, you know, we should tell that poor congressman, look, you know, with all your kickbacks and perks and illegal influence from the lobbyists and so forth, you really make about triple that, so you should be okay.
I think they do all right.
Yeah, they sure do. Hey, one last thing I want to just ask you before you go, Charles, and I appreciate you staying on a little longer.
Oh, sure.
But you alluded to it earlier, and we talked about cryptocurrencies, cybercurrencies, Bitcoin. What do you make of all these? Do you think these things are going to last, or are these just a you know, an interesting anomaly?
Well, I'm in favor of the experiment. I mean, I agree with the Nobel Prize winning economist Friedrich Hayek, who said that, you know, we should have competing currencies and let people separate the wheat from the chaff and decide which ones are of value and which ones they want to use. So I'm glad that this experiment is taking place. It is an experiment, and so I'm happy that people are experimenting, for example, with Bitcoin, with their money, not with mine. I don't architecture. I don't understand the architecture of it, but if it proves to last for a couple of thousand years like gold has, then it will capture my attention. In the meantime, a number of its proponents are making fewer and fewer claims for it that it's a payment system. Well, if it's a payment system, I pay on my computer, I can pay with PayPal, I can pay with MasterCard and Visa. I've got a lot of other payment alternatives. So, you know, Bitcoin isn't, if that's all it is, it's not,
it's not a currency. Yeah, that's just a payment system.
If it were money and a store of value and so on and so forth, that might be something else, but it'll take time to prove that. And in the meantime, I'm not sure what advantage that has over gold, because gold insulates you to the extent you own physical gold. You're insulated from counterparty risk. We know from the Mt. Gox experiment and from many others, you know, that when you have exchanges that you have to deal with and they hold this and you hold that and you hope to redeem it here and there, there's a great deal of counterparty risk, the risk of fraud, embezzlement, and so on and so forth. So I don't see what advantage it has really over gold for my needs. Now, you know,
well,
there are people listening to
this
show have different needs.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's got huge disadvantages over gold. At least gold's something real. All of these cryptocurrencies, including Kanye coin. Let's not forget Kanye West has his own cryptocurrency too. Oh yeah, let's run out and buy that. do people really fall for this stupidity? It's like, I got a Nigerian deal for you, you know?
Yeah, sure.
It's ridiculous.
Somebody came up with, they started circulating the Ron Paul Bitcoin. And I asked Dr. Paul, I said, well, do you think they're honoring you by naming this coin in your name, or are they just exploiting your name and hoping that they can lure people that trust you and what you've represented in to using their coin? He says, probably a little of both, as long as they don't defraud anybody and they operate, you know, honestly, then he wasn't going to, you know, raise a problem about it.
But I'll tell you something. The central banking cartels and the governments that are in cahoots with them, there's no way they're going to let any cryptocurrency or competing currency gain any real traction. And the stupid argument I hear from the, instead of calling them gold bugs, I'm going to call them Bitcoin bugs. From the Bitcoin bugs are, well, the government can't control it. It's decentralized. No, they can control it. Listen, cocaine is decentralized and we're not allowed to trade in cocaine, right? Yeah, you know, that's not a currency. I mean, you know, it's just silly. This stuff is going to be attacked. It's going to be destroyed. It's going to be squashed by the powers that be. And all for our own good, of course, because people will use it for illicit things like prostitution, drugs, and terrorism. And then there will be scams and the government will make the case and then they will just come down on it and it'll be
gone. There'll be all the same things that there are with U.S. dollars. But, you know, I take your point very seriously that they will not let it persist if it becomes a threat to the government's money monopoly. They simply will not.
Which is my argument about competing, you know, alternative currencies outside of the world reserve currency, the dollar. So that, you know, it's kind of like the same argument in a slightly different way.
They will certainly come down with both feet. And, you know, they've already done that. I mean, we have legal tender laws here in this country that make it, you know, the courts won't enforce your contracts denominated in gold the same way they will one denominated in dollars. And they will charge you. And this is what they've done with Bitcoins too. You know, you buy Bitcoins. Well, who ever heard of taxing money? You know, you change your quarters for dollars, your dollars for dimes, they don't tax you. But, you know, if you change your dollars for gold, they tax the transaction. If you change trade your gold back for dollars, and the same with Bitcoin, they want to treat it property the same in the same manner. So they have all of the apparatus of the tax structure to use in their benefit. But, you know, when they get really desperate, the more they crack down, the more heavy-handed they become, the more severe the restrictions are, the penalties, the greater the police state grows to investigate your every financial transaction, then you know that that we're kind of in the end days, because they grow very, very desperate when they're losing their grip on power.
That is true. That is true. And you know, we see police departments around the country arming themselves with insane military tools.
Oh.
Like, who are they fighting? I mean, we've got sheriff departments with tanks. Why do they need tanks?
Yep.
I mean, you know, I need the cop to come over and arrest the
county.
Power, you know,
in my county where I live, Maricopa County, Arizona, Phoenix, world's toughest sheriff, Sheriff Joe Arpaio.
Yeah, I know. I live there, too. I didn't know you were local.
He used a tank to serve a warrant on somebody for cockfighting.
This
he
is
used
insane.
A tank.
I mean, this is insanity. Yeah.
It's insanity.
Yeah, it is. It really is. The America, the police state. Here we are. That's we got to do another show on that, Charles.
Anytime.
Hey, but it's always good to have you back, my friend. Give out any websites you want people to know about. Tell them where they can find you talking with Ron Paul. Whatever.
Sure. Well, by all means, the Ron Paul podcast is worth downloading and listening to. It's become enormously popular. We're really proud of it. And it covers the topics that in depth that you're interested in, not only Dr. Paul on every issue, but also interesting people with unique insights and experiences. It's available at podcastone.com. It's called Ron Paul and Charles Goyette, the weekly podcast. Ron Paul and Charles Goyette, the weekly podcast. It's available at the podcast site, podcastone.com, or on my webpage at charlesgoyette.com, and that's about it.
Charles, I bet that show is going to continue to grow in popularity, and I'll tell you something that is so amazing is as much as the mainstream media tried to push Ron Paul out, not cover him, and, you know, malign him, the people spoke. And you cannot deny the man's popularity. I mean, it is truly incredible, even
it is
without
really
the
something.
Tools of the mainstream establishment.
It is really something that I you know, and having worked with him, I'm still amazed. We're having a recording session. I'm driving him back to the airport. Some guy pulls up in a car alongside of us and practically going berserk, rolling down his window, taking cell phone cameras because he just happened in traffic to see Ron sitting in the passenger side of my car, and he's waving and thumbs up. You know, I'm one of your supporters and stuff. And we see this everywhere, and it's just and especially among young people, you know, college age and older.
Yeah,
it's
no
really
question
amazing.
About it. Well, yeah. Charles Goyette, keep getting the word out there and letting people know about this very, very important stuff.
Sounds good. I thank you, Jason, so much.
Have you listened to the Creating Wealth series? I mean, from the beginning. If not, you can go ahead and get book one, that shows 1-20, in digital download. These are advanced strategies for wealth creation. For more information, go to jasonhartman.com. Thank you for joining us today for the Holistic Survival Show, protecting the people, places, and profits you care about in uncertain times. Be sure to listen to our Creating Wealth Show, which focuses on exploiting the financial and wealth creation opportunities in today's economy. Learn more at www.jasonhartman.com or search Jason Hartman on iTunes. This show is produced by the Hartman Media Company, offering very general guidelines and information. Opinions of guests are their own, and none of the content should be considered individual advice. If you require personalized advice, please consult an appropriate professional. Information deemed reliable, but not guaranteed.